guys.
Revive for Christ, both in America and in the Philippines.
When the church begins to release into the atmosphere a revelation and the understanding of God that needs to be loosed in these last days, it will disassemble and break down all the hindrances the enemy has put in place, all the blockades and everything the devil's done to try to stop it, will not be able to stop it, because what sort of God desires
will be done.
Raising up prophets! He's raising up his body to remind us it's not about religion. It's not about the smoke and the lights and the mirrors. It's about a relationship. It's about the blood.
Christ living and divine.
Praise the Lord. God bless you and welcome on this beautiful Wednesday night. It is WW time for Word Wednesday. I am so glad you joined us this evening. I'm Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover. This is my lovely wife, Apostle Jenny Vanover. And we're glad you're with us tonight. I tell you, before we do anything else, let's go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, as we come before you, we come not with our own ability nor our own power, but God, we come in your spirit and in your anointing. God, loose your anointing in this place tonight. Father, if there be anything of religiosity, anything that brings division, I bind it and take authority over it in the name of Jesus. God, I speak anointing. Let the Holy Ghost take this place over tonight, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Wherever you are, whatever's going on in your life today, don't worry about it. God is there for you. God wants to touch you. God wants to reach you. Stay tuned. God has something special just for you. Praise the Lord. Amen. You ready to praise the Lord?
I am ready. Come on, RFC.
All right, RFC tribe. Lift up your hands. Lift up your hearts. Let's give praise and honor to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Go ahead, prophetess.
Hallelujah. We praise your name. Father, we thank you for all the things you've done, God, during this past revival that we were in, Father. Lord, I pray right now, God, that even during service, Lord, as we're here tonight, Lord, God, I pray that even during our praise and worship to you, that roar will come out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, thank you, Lord.
We are revival. This is revival. We are revival. This is revival. We are revival. This is revival. We're so thankful.
roll tonight. We're gonna roll tonight. You're an army of lions. You're an army of lions. We're gonna roll tonight. We're gonna roll tonight.
This is revival. This is revival. We are revival. We are revival. This is revival. This is revival.
Our eyes to you, God. Oh, we come into the house of the Lord to give him all the glory and all the praise. Oh, we just come, Lord, and we yield ourselves to your spirit. Oh, God, we know that nothing, we can't do anything in ourselves. Oh, but we gotta come and just yield to you, to surrender everything to him right now. Just give him everything. Oh, put yourself in that place where you tell him you're so desperate for him that there's nothing else that'll satisfy or even quench the thirst that is in your soul. Hallelujah. Yes.
Am I going back to the way I was living?
You are welcome in this room.
Oh yes, you are welcome in this place.
Just before you win, I can't shake the feeling. I'm not going back to the way I was living. Holy Ghost, you are welcome.
Oh, yes.
In this room.
Hallelujah.
Just before you win, I can't shake the feeling.
Oh, yes.
I'm not going back. Holy Ghost, you are welcome in this room.
Oh, yes.
Just before you went, I can't shake your feeling. I'm not going back to the way I was living.
Oh, yes.
Holy Ghost, you are welcome in this room.
Holy Ghost, you are welcome.
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 Holy
Ghost, you're welcome in this room.
Oh, yes.
Holy Ghost, you're welcome.
Holy Ghost, you're welcome.
Holy Ghost, you're welcome
in this room.
this room, the men in this room, we yield to you. We yield to you. We yield. Oh, come in this room. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. In this room. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. In this room, Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome. Holy Ghost, you're welcome.
Holy Ghost, you're welcome.
In this room.
Holy Ghost, you're welcome.
In this room.
yes, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for the identity you've given us. Oh, we stand in your presence right now. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. This is revival.
This is revival.
Oh, yes.
We are revival.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah, we praise your name. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise your name, God. Thank you for all that you've done in our lives, God. Father, we will be that tribe, God, that'll give out that roar. Oh, to the nations that need to hear your word. To the nations that need to be shaken up with the truth. We will be that tribe that will have that roar. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Pick up your sword.
up your son, pick up your son, pick up your soul. Let out your roar, let out your roar, let out your roar.
Tell the devil that the trump is coming.
It's coming.
It's coming.
It's coming.
It's coming.
It's coming.
Father, you are wonderful, Father. Lord, we just lift up our hands to you right now. Oh, yadna namasi, the most beautiful experience you'll have with the Lord is when you worship him. Is when you stop every thought and you just get alone with him. And you just reach out your hand. And you reach out your heart. And you reach towards him. Oh, because he is mighty. He is the God of all. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is God Almighty. And in his presence is everything you need. Oh, yes, Jesus, we call upon you. Oh, we stop everything, Lord, and we humble ourselves to you. Oh, yes, Lord, we lay everything down at your feet to tell you you're wonderful, you're beautiful, you're glorious. You're matchless in every way, wonderful. You're beautiful. You're glorious. You're matchless in every way, wonderful. You are
beautiful.
Beautiful.
Glorious.
Glorious. You're matchless in every way,
wonderful.
You are, yes.
Beautiful.
Glorious,
matchless.
International Ministries. It is so good to see the family
of God in the house of the Lord this evening. I know that God has great things in store for his people tonight. And for those of you who are visiting, we welcome you with the love of Jesus Christ. And we want to say hello to all of our brothers and sisters in the Philippines. And those of you on live stream, we pray that the presence and the Holy Spirit of God will touch you right where you are at. All right, the Winds of Fire Flag Worship Team.
Legs are in their folds, and to the earth below, watering this seed to grow. So it is of your precious word, oh no, it won't return until I know.
Like the sun upon my face.
Praise the Lord. Let's hear for the Winds of Fire flag and worship team. They did a great job tonight under the direction of Sister Suzanne Hargrave. Give her another hand, all right? Okay, we're in for a real big treat tonight as we get ready to change the order of the service. We got a great minister and speaker that's going to be coming to minister to you tonight. This is Revival for Christ Club's national evangelist that will be coming and speaking to you tonight. And I want to tell you just a little bit about her. I've known her for a long time. She had her first real relationship and stepping out and ministering for the Lord when she was 14 years old. It's been a long year. I'm just joking. I've known her a long time. She's been one of our main ministers and been our national evangelist for quite some time. She's also right now in charge of a program we called Oil of Freedom, and it's for abusive situations. If you've ever been in an abusive situation, it's a great class to get into. Alethea has a great message concerning that. But I'll tell you, one thing I love about Alethea, Alethea is the real deal. I've been with her and known her for a long time. She serves the Lord, loves God with all of her heart, and I truly believe you're going to be blessed today. Everyone, stand to your feet, and let's welcome and greet our national evangelist, Alethea Colley.
Praise the Lord. How many's glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Amen. How many's glad to be the house of the Lord? Oh, come on. You can do better than that. How many's glad to be the house of the Lord tonight? Hey, I don't know about you, but I am glad to be a part of the body of Christ. I am glad to be, honey, a joint heir with Christ, a part of the body of Christ. I am glad to come in and to be in fellowship with the Holy Ghost, with the Word of God, with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Honey, I am glad, honey, to come in and sit before the throne room of God and to come in and dwell in His presence and to learn of Him. And there's no better place to be than to be in His presence. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's all stand up and go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before You tonight. And Father, we humble ourselves before You. For God, we know without You, we are truly nothing. And God, I pray tonight, God, that Your anointing will move in this place tonight. God, I pray that You remove every bit of flesh. God, I pray that You remove every bit of carnality. God, every vain imagination, every lie of the enemy, every thought that is not like You, God. God, every bit of flesh, we take authority over it. We bind it in the name of Jesus. We curse it and we send it back to hell from where it came from. And God, I pray tonight, Father, that Your Holy Ghost will have complete control tonight, and God, that Your anointing will destroy every yoke of bondage. God, that it will destroy every lie of the enemy. God, that has been spoken over every lie, Father. And Lord, tonight, God, I declare, Father, victory. I declare freedom. And Lord, I proclaim, Father, a new nation. I declare a new people. I declare, Father, a new tribe identity that will be proclaimed in each and every person's life tonight. And Lord, we give You all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, Father. In Jesus' mighty and precious name we pray, Father. Amen. Well, you all can be seated tonight. Excuse me, I know my voice is still a little hoarse. I'm still fighting that cough off a little bit. If you'll ignore the horses, we'll have a good time in the Lord. Amen. You know, I want to pick up from revival. We had an awesome Oktoberfest revival with our chief apostle Timothy Vanover and our apostle Chuck McSweeney, and they preached an awesome revival on our tribe identity and who we are in God. And you know, too many times we let so many other things dictate to us and tell us who we are other than what the Word of God says we are. Too many times we allow our past, we allow the world, we allow our failures, we allow who we think we are, we allow so many other things dictate to us who we and define us who we are, instead of running to the Word of God and allowing the Word of God speak into our lives who God has called us to be, who God has created us to be. And you know what? God is tired of that. God is looking for a people with faith. God is looking for a people that will believe Him at His word and will believe who He has called them to be. Amen. You know, there are simple, most basic scripture that we learn from the time that we get saved. From the very first scripture is what? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should what? That whosoever should what? That whosoever should believe on Him should not perish, but what? Should not perish, but have everlasting life. So the key word there is that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, the key thing there that so many times that we as believers miss out on is we don't believe. We don't have the faith to stand and believe God at His word on who He has called us to be. You know, we heard great messages during this past revival on who God called us to be, on who He anointed us to be, and a roaring tribe, and from the tribe of Judah, a tribe identity that God called us, His believers, His body to be. But how many of us have walked it this week? How many of us have embraced that message and walked in it this week since the revival? Well, this might be something you don't want to hear, but I'm kind of with Apostle on this. I might not be the most popular preacher, but I want you to go with me to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. And you know, I've read this scripture probably throughout my life serving the Lord. I've served the Lord almost my entire life. And I've heard this scripture quoted a million times. I've read it a million times. And I've never quite seen it the way the Lord just broke it down to me. And in James chapter 4 and in verse 17, He says, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth not, to him is sin. You're saying, yeah, I know that. I know the scripture. I got it. Do you really? Come on. Let's look back over it. It says, therefore to him that knoweth to do what? That knoweth to do what? It didn't say evil. It says to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not. And you know, God stopped me right there on my tracks, and He said, to him that knoweth to do good. And He said, what is good to you? What is good? And you know, all of us can give a definition of what good is. You know, to feed the hungry and, you know, don't go out and hurt other people and, you know, all those things like that. We can label so many things as good. But actually, the Bible in Mark, I believe it is, in Mark chapter 10 and verse 18, Jesus, they came and called Him good, and Jesus told them, there is none good but the Father. So Jesus Himself said, I'm not good. He goes, don't call me good. He said, there is none good but the Father. So when he says here to know to do good and do it not is sin. So what is he really talking about? And the Lord's beginning to speak to me. He said to know to do what I have called you to do. To know to do what I have put in you. To know to be who I have called you to be. To know my word. To put my word in action in you and to do it not. He said, that's sin. And I go, but God, I thought sin was when we go out and, you know, do all these bad things. He goes, no, you're not getting it. He said, that's just a manifestation of sin. And I go, what? He goes, the sin was when you turned your back on me. The sin is when you walked away from me. The sin originated when you turned away from my principles. When you turned away from what I called for you to do. When you walked away from who I am in you. When you refused my word. When you refused who I am in you. And you rejected me. And you turned your back from me. And went your own way. And went back to your old man. He said that's where sin originated at. He said all those other things you got in trouble in. He said those were just the manifestations of that sin. So he said, let's bring it closer to home. He said, you know, we live in a society today where nobody wants to be responsible for their own actions. We live in a society today where it's everybody else's fault why you were having a bad day. It's everybody else's fault why you're in the mess that you're in. It's everybody else's fault why you can't be the person that you want to be. And we want to blame everyone else for our problems. And we live in a society today where nobody is taught to take responsibility for their own actions. Well, honey, I'm here to tell you that's not God. God tells us to look at ourselves, to take a good look in the mirror, and to see where our shortcomings are. And you know what the biggest one is? It's when we choose to walk away from God. Because the thing about God is God will never force you to walk with him. God will never force you to be what he's called you to be. Because you know why? Because he is a God of love. And he created you to love him. He created you, honey, to walk with him. To fellowship with him. The whole reason why he sent his son to die for you was because the first Adam gave up that relationship with him when he willingly chose to eat, honey, of that tree in the garden. And you say, then why did God put that tree there? You know why he put it there? Because he had to give man a choice, honey, to give them a free will. Honey, he put it there because he wanted to give them, honey, the free will to choose what they wanted to do. It wasn't about forcing them, honey, to serve him. He wanted them to serve him because they loved him. He wanted them to walk with him in the cool of the day because they loved him. Honey, God never wanted you to serve him and to walk with him because you were made to. That's not love. Do you really want somebody to love you because they have to? Honey, anybody can tell you they love you if you put a gun to their head. But is it real? Is it true? Honey, somebody can tell you they love you to get what they want out of you. There's a lot of that goes around. But see, God created us with a free will. And that's the one thing God will never interfere with, is your free will. He wants you to choose who you're going to serve. He wants you to make the decision and the choice to say, God, I want to serve you. God, I want to choose to pick up the mantle that you have given to me. God, I want to walk with you and to fellowship with you and to know you. God, I want to have a relationship with you. But see, it's a choice that he's looking for you to make. And when we go back to the weak and beggarly elements of our flesh, when we choose, honey, to start looking behind us and not ahead, when we put our hand to the plow, what does the word of God say? Honey, a man that puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of heaven. Why? Honey, because we keep going back to that old man, to that old nature. Honey, that man that's been crucified, and God is saying, you got to let that old man go. You got to quit picking up that old unrenewed man, honey, that old fleshly nature, honey, that God wants to crucify. Honey, you got to let that go. But how many times does God come in and he ministers hope to you? He ministers strength to you. He comes in and he shows you who he's called you to be, and he shows you who he's meant for you to be. But because we don't like the commitment, because we don't like the dedication, because we don't like how it's wrapped up, and then we go back to what is comfortable and easy for our flesh. And we'll say, you know what? I think I like my old ways better. And we're just like those in Ezekiel 8 that turns our back to the Lord and worships our own ways. And the Lord began to show me, he said, you're so quick to believe the lies of the enemy more than you believe my word. You're so quick to tell me everything the devil speaks in your ear. I don't know how many conversations that I have had with people. And I'm not just talking to you, I'm talking to myself too. But how many times that we can tell, I can sit down with someone and I can have an hour long conversation with somebody and they will tell me every lie the devil is speaking in their ear from A to Z and back again. How worthless they are, how everybody else thinks they're worthless, how life is horrible, how bad everything is, how their life is just cruddy, how everything stinks, how nothing will ever come, no good is in their life. I mean, every negative thing they can think of. And you know, I can't tell you how many times I've thought, sat there and thought, so what is God saying in the midst of all this? Can you tell me what God is telling you in the midst of all this? And there's times that the Lord actually have me say that. And I'll go, so what's God telling you? Did God tell you any of that stuff? And they'll go, no. So what did God say? I don't know. Well, of course you don't know because you're too busy listening to the lies of the enemy. You can't hear anything God's got to say because your head and your carnal mind is so full of the lies of the enemy. You got to flush that stinking thinking. You got to get a hold of the Word of God. And you got to get a hold of the Holy Ghost. There is a reason why He says you need His Word and His Spirit. Honey, because your carnal mind is an enmity against God. It is not subject to God, neither indeed can it be. It will never be able to be subject to God because it is an enemy to God. Therefore, you got to crucify that old way of thinking. You got to get rid of that stinking thinking. And you got to get a hold of the Word of God. There have been times in my life that I felt like I was in a pit and I couldn't find a way out. But do you know what helped me get out of that pit? It was this right here. Honey, whenever I felt like I couldn't find a way out, when I picked up the Word of God and I began to cry out to God in my midnight hour, He was that light, honey, that began to shine in that dark place. He was that light, honey, that began to illuminate my path, just like He says in Psalms 119 and 105, that Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Honey, how are you going to make it through those obstacles and through that darkness if you never pick up the Word of God? God is wanting to bring us into a place with Him that we have never been before. But it is going to take a people that are willing to believe Him at His Word and that will walk with Him and walk with His Word and walk with His Spirit in that place. Go with me to Psalms 127. Psalms 127. Now see, there's a way that this takes place, but it isn't the way you want it to be. Psalms 127 and 1. He said, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh, but in vain. What is He telling you here? Except God is building the house, they that build it labor in vain. If you are trying to build your house the way you think it should be built, you are spinning your wheels. You are wasting your time. Honey, you got to let God be the one to build this house the way He wants to build it. Honey, it's got to be according to His Word. It's got to be that measure. Honey, the Word of God is that measure, that measuring reed, honey, that gives the standard for how this house is to be built. And if you're trying to build it any other way, it isn't going to work. You got to go by the Word of God. You got to go, honey, by the Holy Ghost and how He has Him building the house. And if you're trying to build it, honey, any other way than by His Word and Spirit, you are doing it in yourself instead of allowing God to build it. God gave His oath. In Hebrews 6, He gave His oath that by two immutable things, by two unchangeable things, it was impossible for God to lie. And that by these two things, He gave His promise to us, His oath that He would always be there. And you know what that was? There are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And God is making that oath, and those two that he's speaking of is his word and his spirit. And those two things, there when God gives his promise to us, his word to us, it is always by his word and by his spirit. God always does everything through his word and through his spirit. He will not ever deviate from his word and from his spirit. He will always go the path of his word and of his spirit. And if you try to go any other way, it's the wrong way. Go with me to Proverbs chapter 24. Proverbs chapter 24. So during this revival, God talked about us being a part of the line of the tribe of Judah, of having a people that will bring up and be able to roar and to stand up against the lies of the enemy, to stand up against the onslaught of the lies of the enemy when he tries to come in, that we will roar back at that enemy, that we will know who we are in Christ, and that we will know our true identity that is in him, that we are no longer Simon, but we are now Peter, that we are no longer Saul, but we are now, who did he say we are? Who did he say we are? Paul. Who did he say we are? Paul. We are no longer Saul, but we are Paul. We are no longer having that old creation, but he has made us new creation. But see, there is a path to take to get from that old to that new creation. Now see, getting saved and getting filled, honey, with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, honey, is a step. But honey, there's a path that you got to take, because that old nature likes to try to hang on to us. And so you got to get rid of, honey, that old way of doing things that you're accustomed to doing it, honey, that you got to get rid of. But in order to get rid of that old accustomed way of doing it, it takes building new customs. And that new customs is learning to adapt to the word and the spirit. Honey, that transformation of every day, transforming this mind, honey, transforming your ways into the ways of the word and of the spirit, and walking in his ways. But if you never do it, there's never going to be a transformation. Amen. It's unlike popular belief, it's not going to happen by osmosis. Amen. There are those that think just by being around the word and spirit that it'll just happen. No, it doesn't just happen. That's why people can sit in a church pew for 40 years and still split hell wide open. Because it's about a relationship with our Heavenly Father. It's about a relationship with the Word of God. It's about a relationship with the Holy Ghost. And I know that sounds like blasphemy to some people, but I'm here to tell you, that's the path that he set up. So, in Proverbs chapter 24, and in verse 3, he says, through wisdom is a house builded, and by understanding it is established. And by knowledge shall the chambers be filled with all precious and pleasant riches. I want to read this in the Amplified. He says, through skillful and godly wisdom is a house built. through skillful and godly wisdom is a house built. And when the Lord took me here, I said, God, what in the world does this have anything to do with the scripture about to know to do good and do it not is sin? And God said, well, look at this. He said, how is a house built? Through godly wisdom. Through skillful and godly wisdom. And I said, okay, Lord. And then he took me that scripture in Psalms 127. And he said, by my wisdom do I show you how to build a house. And he says, but when you go to your own understanding, you lean to your own understanding, he said, it doesn't work. What does he say in Proverbs chapter 3? Lean not to your own understanding and to your own ways, but acknowledge him in all your ways, and he shall direct your paths. He said, you got to learn to run to the Father. You first got to learn that God is bigger than you. You are not God. He is. You are not the God of this house. And you do not own the title to this house. He does. He is God all by himself. And you have been bought with the price. And honey, you did not pay that price. Jesus Christ did. Honey, so therefore you do not own the title to this house. He does. He purchased it and bought it. Honey, you did not belong to you. Honey, God is God. And he did not put you on the throne. Honey, he is God. And therefore, you got to realize that you need to remove yourself off the throne and let God run to his knowledge and wisdom and let him show you how to build a house. Amen. And then he goes on to say, and by understanding, it is established on a sound and good foundation. And I was like, okay, God, so what does that mean? And the Lord spoke something to me. He said, when is it that you gain understanding of wisdom? He said, do you understand something when someone comes and tells you about something? I said, Randy, you went to college. You've gone for nursing. Before you actually became a nurse, you learned about nursing, right? Did you really fully understand everything you studied? You maybe thought you did. But when did you actually fully start understanding that wisdom? When you actually started using it, right? When you actually became a nurse and actually started putting it in operation, right? That's when you gained that understanding. That's when that house started being established. When you started putting that wisdom in operation. See, what happens? When you start taking the word of God, when you start taking that skillful and godly wisdom, hello, we just had a great revival that God gave us a lot of skillful and godly wisdom from, that he gave us, honey, a path to show us how to have that true tribe identity, honey, to walk in. But how are we going to really gain that understanding if we never take it and put it in operation in our lives? He's showing us how to build this house, but see, how are we going to take it and establish, honey, that understanding in this house if we never apply it? See, when we gain understanding is when we start applying, putting in application the word of God and using what's been given to us. And then we go, ah, that does work. See, it's one thing to read something and you say, yeah, I saw somewhere that, you know, if you do this and this and this, this will work. But you don't really know if it works because you just read it or you heard somebody say it. But it's when you actually go use it for yourself when you find out if it really works. True? Well, it's the same way with the Word of God. You're never going to know if the Word of God works in your life if you never use it. If you never pick up the Word and put it in operation in your life. Honey, when you find yourself in a crossroads or in a place of trouble or in your midnight hour, if you don't ever run to the Word or pick it up, how do you know it's going to work for you? Honey, it isn't just about what the preacher says up here on Sunday or Wednesday. It's about what you use on Monday and Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, when the preacher's on around. And it's just you and God. What are you doing with it? What are you doing at home with it? Amen? And I know this sounds so basic. But see, it's easy to walk out those doors and forget what was preached. And that's why we find ourselves going through the same things over and over again and never progressively getting more acquainted and intimately acquainted with our Heavenly Father and really becoming the vessels He's called us to be, because we keep walking out the door forgetting, honey, what was ministered to us here, and we don't put it in operation in our lives, and we keep wondering why we're not changing, why we're not really becoming the vessels He's called us to be. But honey, I'm here to tell you that there is a day coming, honey, that we don't have time to wait for you to decide whether you want to be committed or not, or whether you want to take the Word or not. But there's a day coming, honey, you're going to have to know God for yourself, and you're going to have to be able to stand up and say, God, Lord, I know You beyond a shadow of a doubt. It's not through a man or through an individual, but God, I know You, that You are my Lord and King, that You are my Savior. And God, I know that You are real. See, you're going to have to know Him one-on-one for you. You're going to have to know God in the midnight hours, because, honey, they're coming. And you're not going to have time to go run to pastor or chief or your apostle Jenny to say, I need your help. You're going to have to know how to get a hold of God for you. And God is looking for an army of people that knows who they are in Him. God is looking for an army of people that know who He is. And that know who they are in Him. And an army of people, honey, that are going to walk hand in hand. That are going to walk linked up, arm in arm. That are going to be unbreakable. That are going to walk steadfast and sure, honey, in Him. And that are going to be able to flow, honey, in the wind of the Spirit. And they're going to move in one direction, honey, being unbroken and unmovable in Him. But honey, today is not that day. But I promise you, God is raising up a people like that. And God is looking for a people. And that is why God is saying, it is time for you to begin, honey, to know who you are in Him. It is time for you to begin to start putting in operation and believing Him at His word on who He's called you to be. And He said, and by knowledge, I love this, and by knowledge shall its chambers of every area be filled with all precious and pleasant riches. By that knowledge shall the chambers be filled. Every area, honey, that knowledge, who is, honey, that knowledge, Honey, that rock that we receive of Christ's knowledge. Honey, that knowledge, honey, he's going to fill every chamber, every area of your heart, every area, honey, that maybe was hidden, every area that maybe the devil had hidden for so long that you didn't think any light could get to. God's saying, if you'll let me build the house, if you'll let me come in and you'll put in, honey, my word, and you'll take it and put it in operation in your life, honey, he said, I'm going to fill every chamber of your heart, every area of your life, and I'm going to fill it with my riches, with my pleasant riches, honey, and with all those pleasant things of God, honey, those jewels, those gems of his word and of his spirit that is going to fill this heart and this life, honey, that way the enemy can't come in and say you're not worthy, that you don't have anything in you, honey, for this house is going to be filled, honey, with the glory of God. And you're going to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are a royal priesthood and a holy nation, that you are a peculiar people, a chosen generation, that you are his people, called by his name. See, God is looking for a people that said, God, I am yours and you're mine. See, that people that walks in that new covenant, honey, that he's going to write his ways on the tables of their heart and in their mind, that they will be his people and he will be their God, that they will know his ways, that no man's going to have to teach them, honey, for they will know God. And he's saying, will you be my people? Will you be my people that'll stand up and rise up and know that I am your God? That I will write my ways upon the tables of your heart and in your mind, that you will allow me to be the God that writes upon the tables of your heart. And that won't turn your back to me when I call out to you. See, we live in a world and in a time where man wants to dictate to God who they want him to be. But God is saying, I will not have that. And God's saying, I'm looking for a people. I'm looking for an army of people that says, God, I want to know you truly for who you are. God, I ain't looking for a fancy word. I'm not looking for something popular. I'm not looking for something to tickle my ears or to make me feel good. But God, I want to know you for who you truly are. God, I don't want my ways. I don't want to change your word, God. I don't want to live a lie. See, we live in a time and a day where we have changed the word of God into a lie. And we've made the lie into a truth. Will you make the word of God into a lie in your life as well? Will you as well follow the path that others are doing? If you're not careful, you can be sucked into the same path. Because see, the devil doesn't come in with a pitchfork and say, oh, I'm the devil. He comes in a slight inclination of error. See, he comes in with a little bit of error. Just a touch of error. A little bit at a time to desensitize you. Just a little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump to where it perverts the whole household of faith. And don't we see that happening in the church today? But see, God, this is why God is saying to know to do good and do it not as sin. Because for too long, we have found ourselves turning our back to the truth. We have found ourselves turning our back, honey, to the good, to God, when He has spoken to us and we run after our own ways. And God is saying no more, that I'm looking for a people that won't turn their back to me any longer, but I am looking for a people that will rise up and say, God, I want your truth. God, I want your word. God, I want your spirit. Even if it means I have to die, even if it means my life, God, I will lay my life down for your truth. I will lay my very life down if that's what it takes for the truth to be brought forth. But will you be those people? Will you rise up and be the people that God has called you to be? And it be the lions that will roar, and it with that truth to say, I will not sit back any longer and wait for somebody else to do it. I won't sit back any longer and let somebody else take my place. I will not sit back any longer and wait on somebody else, but I'm going to rise up and be the vessel that God anointed me to be. Stand up to your feet tonight. Honey, the days are short. Don't be a fool in thinking you have a long time. Don't be a fool in thinking that you have years or whatever to get your house in order. Yeah. Or to think that you have time to do your own thing. You better think again, because you may just find yourself on the other side of this. Yeah. The days are short. And honey, there is a moving. There is a moving in the Spirit. And the Spirit of the Lord is moving across this land. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, I'm looking. I'm looking. I'm looking for those. I'm looking for those that'll say, yes, God. Yes, God, I'm going to stand. Yes, God, I'm going to go. Yes, God, I will go. Send me. Yes, God, I will go. Send me. Honey, it isn't time for you to wait for the person next to you to get committed. And I'm sorry if your mom and daddy aren't ready. I'm sorry if your spouse isn't ready. I'm sorry if whoever next to you isn't ready. But God is asking you if you are ready. And He is looking to you. And He is asking you. This is between you and Him. And He's saying, are you ready to answer the call? Are you ready to be who I ordained you to be? Are you ready to be a vessel that I created you to be, with no excuses? You've been on my heart all day long. I wasn't going to pray for you, but God had to. Oh, my kid, oh no, seed, yana, my seed, yana, so nigh. La na na si ni o no ho la na si por ran si ni a na masanda ni na mahana ya si ni a na masona ho la na na masanda por ran si ni a na masona ho la na masi ho la na masi. Daughter, where are your accusers? For I do not forgive you. So why do you condemn us? Why do you listen to the lies of others? You know you were made for this day. You know that is the reason why you draw breath in your body. But yet, the lies. Ah, the lies of the enemy. But daughter, know that I am your father. I am your God, and you know my voice. Daughter, call out to me, and I will be there. I will be there for you. Even as I have been with you every day of your life, so shall I be with you for the rest of thy days. Daughter, know that I am your God, and I will walk with you. And if you will cry out to me, I will strengthen you, I will build you, and I will make you a strong tower in this last day, saith the Lord. Oh.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our over 17 churches in the Philippines, to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send your text or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.